Grace and peace be to each of you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is indeed the Christ, the Anointed One of God. And let us pray. Good and gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, and thank you for gathering us here in this place to worship and praise you, and to hear your word proclaimed. Lord, we continue John, and particularly John chapter 7. We pray, Heavenly Father, that as we seek to understand this word, you would give us the insight that we need. Lord, we can't know anything about your word unless you reveal it to us, and so we ask for revelation. Lord, we also ask that you would touch every heart that receives this word. And we pray it would be a blessing to many. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, last week we began John chapter 7. Jesus' brothers wanted him to go to Jerusalem with them to the Feast of Tabernacles, because they said anyone who wants to become somebody, you know, goes to where the crowds are and makes himself known. Jesus' answer to his brothers reminded them that though the world operates that way, he doesn't operate that way. He had come from heaven and he came to do what he saw the Father do. He came to speak the truth, which the world didn't want to hear. Jesus knew that the religious leaders in Jerusalem wanted to kill him. So he didn't go up to Jerusalem at the same time with his brothers. And last week we heard that though all of us are born into the world, which hates God, when we came to faith in Jesus Christ, or when we come to faith in Jesus Christ, we are transferred from the kingdom of this world to God's kingdom. The challenge, of course, is that we remain in the world. We still live here. And there are plenty of temptations around us to follow the ways of the world rather than live as citizens of the kingdom of heaven. Sadly, if we continue to follow the ways of the world, well, then the world is going to conclude that being in God's kingdom is of no advantage to them. So there's no reason for them to choose Christ. Well, that would be a tragedy for them, not only then, but in the future, in eternity. We really do need to live as citizens of the kingdom of heaven. We really do need to do that. The world needs us to do it because the world needs Jesus. Today we begin at verse 10. And there we read, "But when his brothers had gone up, then he also went up to the feast, not openly, but as it were in secret. Then the Jews sought him at the feast and said, 'Where is he?' And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him. Some said, 'He is good.' Others said, 'No, on the contrary, he deceives the people.'" You know, as we read here, it was always Jesus' intent to go up to the feast, just not when his brothers wanted him to go up to the feast. Now, as an aside, and it's kind of a brief rabbit trail, let me say, what is interesting about the Feast of Tabernacles is that it was a week-long feast, and it was a time when the Jews would come to Jerusalem and build little booths, and they would stay in those booths for a week. And being in those booths, being out under the stars at night, it depicted them being with the Lord and dwelling with the Lord for that week under the stars. The feast itself foreshadows the day in which God himself will permanently dwell among his people. Obviously, most of the feast goers didn't know that God was already dwelling among them in the person of Jesus. John, however, makes this point perfectly clear in John chapter 1 when he writes, "And the Word," when God, "became flesh and made his dwelling among us." The word translated here as dwelling is better translated tabernacled. When the Greek word eskenosin is translated tabernacle, well, then we can make it an easy connection between Jesus tabernacling among us and the Feast of Tabernacles. What Jesus did for a time, God is planning to do permanently. Our God longs to dwell with us. And that's what's going to happen in time. Another thing we see in these few verses is the division among the people regarding who Jesus is. Some said he is good. Others, no, on the contrary, he deceives the people. Well, here is the bulletin alert for the day. No one can remain neutral about Jesus. And everyone is going to get to decide if they're going to receive him as Savior and Lord or not. Everybody's going to decide, okay? The fact that some said he is good and others said no, on the contrary, he deceives the people, points this out. The Jewish leaders, they sought Jesus, well, not because they believed in him, but because he judged them for being the hypocrites that they were. And because of that, they wanted to kill him. I think it was during Holy Week when I read through a couple of the woes of Matthew 23. But these are some of the things that Jesus pointed out to them that they didn't like to hear. I'll read a couple of those woes. But woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for you neither go in yourselves, nor do you allow those who are entering to go in. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you travel land and sea to win one proselyte, and when he is won, you make him twice as much a son of hell as yourself. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! For you pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faith. These you ought to have done without leaving the others undone. Blind guides, you strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Well, that's only three of the eight. Well, such truths did not endear Jesus to these religious leaders. What they ought to have done, of course, after having heard the woes directed at them, they should have examined their hearts to see if the things Jesus was saying about them was true. And when they came to realize that, yes, indeed, everything that Jesus was saying about them was true, then they should have repented and turned to him. But of course, most of them didn't do this. Instead, most of the religious leaders sought to kill Jesus rather than change their own attitude and actions. Tragic. What we also see in this section is that the religious leaders must have wielded an awful lot of power. Because in verse 13, we read how their attitude toward Jesus shut down any kind of conversation regarding Jesus. In verse 13, we read, he's a good man. No, he deceives the people. Verse 13 says, however, no one spoke openly of him for fear of the Jews. What do the people fear? They feared being thrown out of the synagogue. Verse 14. Now about the middle of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, how does this man know letters, having never studied? Letters meaning the law, the prophets, and the writings, and the things that the Jews have in their traditions. These men assumed that Jesus needed to have gone to one of their schools to have knowledge of the law and the prophets and the writings. Not so. Jesus had a much better school. He was taught by his Father in heaven. Even at a young age, at the age of 12, Jesus astonished the teachers of the law in the temple. If Jesus astonished the teachers of the law at age 12, how much more would we expect him to astonish them as a young man in his 30s? So that the teachers of the law understood where Jesus got his knowledge from, Jesus tells them, beginning at verse 16. Jesus answered and said to them, "My doctrine is not mine, but his who sent me. If anyone wills to do his will, he shall know concerning the doctrine whether it is from God or whether I speak on my own authority. He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory, but he who seeks the glory of the one who sent him is true, and no unrighteousness is in him. Did not Moses give you the law? Yet none of you keeps the law. Why do you seek to kill me?" Now that's such a switch at the end of this little section, that, and we'll get into why that is, but it really is interesting. It's like, you know, Jesus is making all these statements about, you know, him seeking the glory of the one who sent him, and then he flips it and he says, "You have the law of Moses. Why are you trying to kill me?" It's like, what's the deal here? You know, he obviously knew that the Jews were trying to kill him. He also very clearly let them know who taught him. Okay? The one who sent him is the one who taught him. He was taught directly from his Father in heaven. If Jesus had been going about Jerusalem and Judea and the surrounding areas teaching his own ideas and doing his own thing, well, that would be an issue. You know, then he would have been promoting himself. That would have been a problem. However, Jesus wasn't teaching his own ideas. He was teaching what the Father had taught him. Not only was Jesus teaching what the Father taught him, he was doing what the will of the Father was. And this is why he adds verse 19 in there. You see, what Jesus did was a far cry from what the Jewish leaders did. You see, in essence, in this little section, he's pointing out the difference between what he is doing and what the Jewish leaders were doing. He was doing the Father's will, which, by the way, what the Father taught him and what the law of Moses was, there wasn't any difference because God is God. Okay? So he's pointing out that I'm doing my Father's will. I'm following what my Father wants me to do. He says, "You've got the law of Moses and you're not doing it." Why weren't they doing it? They were seeking to kill him. What does the law of Moses say? Thou shalt not kill. And so he's like, "Why do you seek to kill me? You've got the law of Moses. Why are you trying to kill me? I've got what my Father has taught me, and I'm doing it." The difference between Jesus and the Jews was Jesus was being obedient to the Father, and the Jews were not. Then we hear in verse 20, the people answered and said, "You have a demon. Who is seeking to kill you?" Well, what's interesting here is the text says it's, you know, people who are asking him who's seeking to kill you. So there seems to be a difference between the Jews who, you know, some of them did want to kill him and these people, but we don't get identified who these people are. But surely there were people who didn't know what the Jews were planning. And so they're going, "What are you talking about?" And of course they just assume he must have a demon for thinking such thoughts. But what's interesting in this particular section, or a little bit, you know, as we're getting into it, Jesus identifies the exact moment when the Jews began to plot to kill him. Okay? Verse 21, Jesus answered and said to them, "I did one work and you all marveled. Moses, therefore, gave you circumcision, not that it was from Moses, but from the fathers. It originated with Abraham. And you circumcise a man on the Sabbath. If a man receives circumcision on the Sabbath so that the law of Moses should not be broken, why are you angry with me because I made a man completely well on the Sabbath? Do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment." What's he talking about? Well, the Jews circumcised babies on their eighth day, baby boys. And if the eighth day fell on the Sabbath, they circumcised them. You know, they didn't bat an eye to do it. They just did it because it was the eighth day and that's what you're supposed to do. That's what the law says. Jesus healed the man at the pool of Bethesda on the Sabbath. Oh, the whole man. He'd been there for 38 years and they took issue with it. Jesus is saying, you're not judging rightly. You're not thinking about this. Jesus could have also pointed out, he didn't, but he could have also pointed out that the priests work every Sabbath. Because there's a morning sacrifice, there's an evening sacrifice. And the high priest doesn't sit down until he can say, nag more, it's all done. He could have pointed that out. But since they were talking about and accusing him of healing on the Sabbath, he goes for that particular area of the law and says, you circumcise, on the eighth day. That involves a little part of a person's body. I heal the whole man and you're going to want to kill me. They're not thinking. The fact of the matter is, a lot of people don't think the faith. They just do their tradition and never try to get out of that little box that their tradition has put them in. And of course, if people want to break out of the tradition, well, then people get all up in arms. Jesus says, don't judge according to appearance. Judge with righteous judgment. Think about the faith. Think about what I did. Had the Jewish leaders and the people been judging rightly, they would have rejoiced with what Jesus was doing. But what had happened? The Jews, particularly the scribes, they had put a fence around the law. And they'd made it so rigid that people couldn't go outside those borders. And since, circumcising on the eighth day was part of that, they could do it. The priests, because they worked on the Sabbath, it was in the border, so they could do it. But boy, anybody get outside that border, do something a little different? Oh, no. And since it was on the Sabbath, you're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. Jesus was working on the Sabbath, therefore he must die. Verse 25. Now some of them from Jerusalem said, is this not he whom they seek to kill? So there's some people that know that the authorities want to kill him. There are some that have no clue as to what's going on. Now some of them from Jerusalem said, is this not he whom they seek to kill? But look, he speaks boldly and they say nothing to him. Do the rulers know indeed that this is truly the Christ? However, we know where this man is from, but when the Christ comes, no one knows where he is from. Clearly, we see in John chapter 7 that people have a lot of questions as to who Jesus is. I mean, earlier we heard he's a good man. No, he deceives the people. Now we hear, do the rulers, have they figured out that he's the Christ? I don't know. However, when he says, well, so there are a lot of questions in chapter 7. Of course, we have the whole Bible. We're looking back on this. They're thinking, we know where this man is from when the Christ comes. Now, they say that because they had traditions that said, when the Christ comes, we won't know where he's from. That's where this saying is coming from here. Since we have the whole Bible, we're looking back on it, we're all thinking, hello, people, Jesus is the Christ. It's one and the same person. But you got to understand, they're living this in real time, and they really are trying to figure this out. And chapter 7 gives us a clue as to how they're trying to work through all this and try to figure it out. The fact is that you can't figure it out with your brain. It's got to be revealed by God. It's got to be revealed by God that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And of course, we see that in Matthew chapter 16. You know, when Jesus asked the question to his disciples, he says, "Who do men say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, some others, Jeremiah, one of the prophets. But who do you say that I am?" And that's when Peter said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then Jesus said, "Blessed are you, Simon the son of Jonah. Flesh and blood did not reveal this to you, but my Father who is in heaven revealed it to you." See, it's got to be spiritually revealed. You can't just think about it in your brain and figure this out. Some of these things, you know, the deep, deep things of God, they really have to have God unlock it for us. And the vast majority of the people in Jerusalem, you know, they hadn't made these connections yet. They were still wondering who Jesus was. And Jesus' answer to them was this: "You know me. You both know me and you know where I'm from. I have not come of myself, but he who sent me is true, whom you do not know. But I know him, and I am from him, and he sent me. Therefore they sought to take him, but no one laid a hand on him, because his hour had not yet come. And many of the people believed in him and said, 'When the Christ comes, will he do more signs than these, which this man has done?'" That's where we're going to stop today, and I'm not going to go into that. I'll go into this more next week. But we're going to jump right back into this section next week, because, you know, this section is going to let us jump into the next section and the next section. But really, John chapter 7 is all about these people trying to figure out who Jesus is. And ultimately, Jesus is going to invite them to come to him. Amen.